surgeries by Dr. Asit Vaishnav. He is a freelance consultant and a sociologist in Rajkot. His total working experience in a specialty of 38 years in a various field. He was founder secretary of Jamnagar City branch for 3 years. He was a secretary of GSB ISA for 6 years. He was a president of ISA Rajkot City branch for 3 years. He organized state conference as an organizing secretary at Jamnagar in 87 and organizing chairman at Rajkot in 2007. He is a member of many society. I invite Dr. Asit Vaishnav to deliver his speech.
Should we wait for 10 more minutes to people to come in? After a quick refreshing tea break, we are meeting again for continuing our learning process in pediatric anesthesia. And I have been working on cleft surgery patients for last 10 years, practically for last 10 years. I am associated with Smile Train Partner Hospital, Dhruv Plastic Surgery Hospital at Rajkot, and we cater to patients of Smile Train brought by government medical officers and referred by other pediatricians from all over Saurashtra and in region of Saurashtra. We are providing Smile Train services for cleft surgery patients, and we get lot many patients. So out of that, my experience, I'm giving you few tips. So prevalence of cleft lip or a palate is very high in society, and around one in 700 live births. Of course, the figures are from UK, from our country. We do not have such statistical figures, and we have to rely upon it. But the prevalence is very high among other congenital anomalies. And surgeons operating for this cleft palate surgery, cleft lips and cleft palates, are pediatric surgeons. Even ENT surgeons also operate in some areas on lip and palates. Maxillofacial surgeons also were operating on this type of patients. And now most of the surgeries are being done by plastic surgeons, and Smile Train program gives recognition to the center where plastic surgeon operates. Previously, I was doing hardly 10 surgeries a year, but now after association with this program, I do 3 to 10 surgeries in a week, and by now more than 1,000 cleft surgeries are done at our center in last 9 years. Cleft lips and surgeries are associated with many other anomalies, and there is a list of it. You can go through it on net or in books. It is easily available. Anesthesia or anesthetist with in cleft lip and cleft patients. Cleft lip and cleft palate patients. Primary anesthetist involved in surgical repair in childhood. He is also asked for airway management, primary airway management, before and during surgery. Chance of losing, and most important thing in this type of surgery is chance of losing airway during surgery. Most patients present with isolated cleft lip but may have associated anomalies. The most obvious are other defects of brachial arch, of ear and upper airway defects. They are also associated with heart, renal and skeletal anomalies. Surgery in adulthood is also there in these patients. Mostly it is done in childhood, but we get adult patients also 7 years, 12 years, 13 years and One patient we operated was of 36 years for primary palate repair. Till that age, nobody has attended to it, the patients, because the patient was practically useless to the society, being in some mentally retarded patient. So did we get adult patients also for that? Surgery in adulthood, so primary surgeries, for redo surgeries for lip aesthetics, residual palatal defects, bone graft and alignment of alveolar and dental defects, realigning the jaws, correction of nasal deformities, otitis media, and non-cleft related anomalies also we get the patients. The usual age of surgery is 6 to 12 weeks for lip, and that is recommended nowadays, and palate at the 3 to 9 months. Mineral surgery is very unusual. Mostly it is for non-cleft surgeries. For non-cleft operations also, these patients may come to you for surgeries. We had a patient last week which was operated previously for duodenal atresia on the fourth day of birth. So we do get such type of patients for non-cleft surgeries also as a neonatal emergencies. Worldwide it is trend. So waiting for till 3 months of age gives time to detect most other congenital anomalies and allows anatomical and physiological maturation. Worldwide it is trend to do it earlier for better cosmetic results and to promote normal speech development and reduce nasal regurgitation. Many patients are referred to us within a day or month of birth for consultation. People are aware of it, and usually in urban area, on the very second day of birth, they are referred from a pediatrician, or out of anxiety, they are referred to us for the surgery. Early preoperative visits allow time to assess general and specific problems, as well as provide information for training to the parents about nutritional support, chance to explain the plan of surgery, associated risks of anesthesia and surgery, and possibility of additional measures such as postoperative nasopharyngeal airway insertion, and all these things we can teach them and guide them. But at our center, we prefer to do cleft lip after 5 months of age or attaining 5 kg of weight, and cleft palate after 10 months or 10 weeks and 10 kg weight. This allows us good anatomical and physiological maturation. Age at surgery, at large, a later age, lip patients may require refashioning for lip and nostril. Around 20% will require a pharyngoplasty or palatal augmentation Z-plasty, that is furlough procedure for velopharyngeal incompetence and to improve speech. Early primary palatal surgery before 1 year disrupts normal palatal growth, and despite orthodontic treatment may require sometimes significant maxillofacial surgery in their teens to correct mid-face hypoplasia and maxillary retrusion. Most of the patients are under regular treatment with pediatrician for recurrent respiratory tract infection and seen by pediatricians at CHCs if they are coming from rural setup before referring to us. If it is not, we do insist for pediatric reference associated with the program. Associated minor ailments. Upper respiratory tract infections are practically common at this age and carry an increased risk, as mentioned previously, of airway complications and impaired wound healing. Though many of these patients have a continuous nasal discharge without overt infection, we do not use routine prophylactic antibiotics for low grade nasal discharge unless total count is more than 15,000. However, for palate surgery, routine and targeted treatment with antibiotics reduces the chances of postoperative pyrexial illness. Anemia may be seen because of combination of nutritional and physiological causes. Cleft lip defects make it difficult for an infant to create a seal sufficient to suckle. HB of 10 is the minimal threshold for selection for palate, and HB of 8 for unilateral incomplete cleft lips. No pre-op BT to improve hemoglobin. Airway in cleft patients. The surgery is in a category of airway surgery, and per se, only cleft lip do not lead to upper airway obstruction. There is surgery This is generally a result of other problems, structural or neuromuscular, affecting the normal function of upper airway. Most important group of cleft lip and palate patients with airway problems are with micrognathia, glossoptosis, cleft, which is termed as Peary-Robin sequence. The primary deformity is micrognathia, resulting into a tongue position further back in the oropharyngeal cavity, which leads to reduced pharyngeal space, preventing palatal fusion, and at birth or soon after, upper airway obstruction of varying degrees. Management of respiratory obstruction at birth in such patients. A clear airway is of paramount importance after birth. First time management consists of placing the infant in prone position. This may suffice for milder forms. Next is to provide an artificial airway, usually nasopharyngeal airway. Very rarely, obstruction is severe and complicated and may require surgical intervention. Airway, again continuing, as usual, preparation is paramount importance. Cleft lip and palate requires all the normal facilities of pediatric care. Anesthesia for cleft lip and cleft palate doesn't differ from other patients. Other usual care, other usual facilities and other principles do apply over here. So normal facilities of pediatric care should be available together with those for dealing with potential airway difficulties. A difficult face mask ventilation is rare, but airway becomes obstructed after loss of consciousness. Options include turning the patient's lateral or semi-prone and use of an oral or nasopharyngeal airway. Laryngeal mask airway also may help during such situation and may enable to ventilate and achieve the adequate depth of anesthesia for direct laryngoscopy and intubation to be tolerated. A such smile train program do provide LMA for dealing with the crisis of CVCI situations, and they do not recommend routine use of it, but for a rescue device, they do recommend laryngeal mask airway, and they provide with that program of LMA Supreme size 1 and 2. They provide with the program, and that had tided over crisis once or twice in these 1,000 patients. If unable to secure the airway, allowing the patient to wake up and deferring the surgery when they are older. They have more structural and neuromuscular maturity, and when the airway becomes easier to manage. Yes, one child was referred to us with Peary-Robin syndrome. Assessment wise also, we felt that we might face a difficulty. The child was around 5 months or so, and it was for lip as well as palate. But for lip, we clearly made it clear that if we will be able to intubate, then and then we will be proceeding, or else we will be postponing. We tried it under inhalation anesthesia, thrice laryngoscopy. We couldn't see larynx at all. We tried with other options, but at that age, other options are also not there. At the age of 6 months, we do not have other options to deal with it. Tried it with boogie, but couldn't intubate. We woke up the child and postponed it for a year. And after attaining age of 1.5 years, we could successfully do first lip surgery followed by palate surgery. So this may be the good option to deal with such patients. Early surgical emergency surgical airway is very difficult option in this group, but may be needed to secure subsequent maintenance of the airway. Preparation for routine intubation. Yes, all type of laryngoscope blades, airways, oropharyngeal, nasopharyngeal airways, Bagel's forceps, pediatric boogie. These are essentials. And for anticipated difficult airway, video laryngoscope and other model, that is laryngeal mask airway, also kept ready. And in this patient, but nothing required, particularly in this patient last week only, nothing required, and we could intubate easily. But it was anticipated that in this patient we may require some aid, but it was an easy one later on. Airway in cleft surgery is wide cleft. Difficult view to, there is a difficulty in viewing the larynx. It is more common in difficult, it is difficult than, so viewing larynx is more common difficulty in wide cleft. A large alveolar cleft may make positioning of the laryngoscope difficult, and it, the edge falls in the cleft. The options are putting a wide gauze pack in the cleft, straightway laryngoscopic blade, or a video laryngoscope, or a lateral or molar approach, and early external laryngeal manipulation and pediatric boogie guided intubation. So in this patient, wide cleft, we have wide cleft patient. There are three angle views, and we are ready for that patient. And that trolley was made for this patient again for last week. This the first is first figure shows. Yes, Anita sir. Yes, first figure shows that our laryngoscope engages in the cleft. Second option shows putting a gauze roll in the cleft, and we can go for that. The second one more option is a molar approach, lateral approach, molar approach, where our laryngoscope will not engage in the cleft at all. And the fourth option is straight blade. The last one is straight blade. So wide cleft, LMA also provides an excellent mean to maintain the airway and ventilate, but that is the last option. Securing the airway after intubation, positioning over the rolled towel, applying blade of mouth gauge, compression of the tube. Sorry, this is now losing the airway. Losing the airway after intubation. After successful intubation, there are chances of losing the airway during surgery. That is, first thing is during positioning over the rolled towel, or applying blade of mouth gauge. Again, a compression of tube with the blade of mouth gauge at the teeth or blade tip, or reposition of the mouth gauge. At all this point, you can patient get accidentally extubated, or removal of mouth gauge at the end of surgery. That these are the time where your successfully intubated patient may get extubated. So again, at extubation, there is collapse of airway and laryngospasm. Patient should be extubated when fully awake with close observation for signs of airway obstruction. Monitoring, by no way anesthesia in cleft lip differs from any standard pediatric anesthesia except for airway problems. So standard monitoring is a rule. ECG, SpO2, ETCO2 are must. Capnography is an indispensable tool, and mainstream capnography is more accurate. Side stream is known to give erroneous results, low readings. So in older children with NIBP will also helps in maintaining good monitoring. Core temperature monitoring is also helpful, particularly for cleft lip patients, because they are operated at earlier age, and AGM is a luxury, though I do have it. Induction of anesthesia, if we, it has already been discussed previously, but what we do is, if vein is not secured preoperatively or anticipated difficult airway, again, we apply monitoring. All monitors first, ECG is applied, and mask induction. Inhalation induction with 100% O2 and halothane or sevoflurane. Previously we had halothane, now we do not have halothane at all. And 100% oxygen with sevoflurane is our induction technique if vein is not available or there is difficult anticipated difficult airway. After securing vein, glycopyrrolate or atropine in a cleft palate patients. If adequate relaxation is achieved, check laryngoscopy and sometime direct intubation. If larynx is viewed but not comfortable with relaxation, small dose succinylcholine helps achieving good laryngeal view. If confident of intubation, etracurium is also preferred. If larynx or aritonides are not seen, spontaneous respiration is not paralyzed. Avoiding muscle relaxants, deepening anesthesia with laryngeal mask helps changing blade, external manipulation, boogie, all these things helps in induction But not paralyzing the patient is the key of success. Only one patient was postponed so far for a year, that I have already told you. If vein is secured preoperatively after applying monitors and nasal O2, high flow nasal, we do not have it, but at least 15 liters per minute nasal oxygen we give, we start after cleft palate. And in cleft palate, we do use glycopyrrolate 4 mics per kg and midazolam 0.04 milligram per kg, tramadol 2 milligram per kg, or dexmedetomidine 1 mic per kg plus fentanyl 2 mics per kg over 10 minutes. Then we start with intravenous induction, propofol 2 to 2.5 milligram per kg, and as the doctor said previously, we may require 4 to 5 milligram per kg depending upon the patient. Plus 0.5 milligram per kg ketamine is added nowadays, these days, to have better analgesia. Good laryngoscopic use is achieved with muscle relaxants. I do directly in almost all patients when vein is available, propofol etracurum induction. Endotracheal tube fixation and positioning. Our choice is non-cuffed preformed south polar tubes till size of 5.5. Cuffed tubes above size of 6, though to fit with the intermediate seal, 5.5 and 6.5 non-cuffed tubes are also kept ready. Positioning at surgery keeps blood and secretion away from the larynx. Deep throat packing in palate cases where there is a leak around the tube. Mouth and full throat packing in lip cases. Non-fitting tubes gives peritube leakage, bubbling, frothing, an annoying smell to surgeon. Low ETCO2 reading and typical leakage wave on capnograph. I will show you. Tube is secured with adhesive tape at chin. After confirming bilateral air equal air entry and 4 consecutive equal capnographic traces, we fix the tube. Eye is protected with ointment and tapes. Extended head position is given on rolled towel under shoulder or pillow. ETT position is reconfirmed with capnography and bilateral equal air entry after positioning. This is most important. Even I have trained my staff that if any other anesthetic is there in index during anesthesia, I request him to reconfirm the position of tube after positioning the patient. I have trained them to request them politely to draw their attention that, sir, please check the tube again after positioning. Circuit is fixed with chest underneath patient's clothes, and all this is done in knot. Everything is knotted in the knots. That yes, this was done, this was done, this was done, this was done. These days it is necessary to note down what you have done. So we fix the endotracheal tube at chin without distorting the lip, and we fix the circuit under the clothes of a patient. We do not use tape over body to fix the tubes. So this is the leakage wave in capnograph. There is a leak around the tube, and you can see the truncated cone shape CO2 wave. And after packing, after throat packing, deep throat packing, we can see the improvement in capnograph waves. Maintenance Jackson wrist circuit in less than 10 kg and limb O closed circuit above 10 kg patients. Easy short duration leap, spontaneous ventilation with oxygen nitrous oxide and isoflurane. We can call it VIMA. Long cases, etracurum is added and ventilated with, in VC mode, piston-driven max ventilator and attached to an open end of the Jackson wrist circuit or bag of closed circuit with tidal volume of 8 ml per kg and rate of 13 to 18 depending upon the age of the patient. Surgeons infiltrate with adrenaline saline. We add bupivacaine to it, making it 0.25% bupivacaine. And surgeon also gives palatal block during palate surgery, which provides good postoperative analgesia also. Paracetamol is suppository at the end of surgery and ringer lactate with dextrose 1.2% as per formula. Reversal and extubation. Reversal is must even with trachurium, throat peck is removed, hemostasis confirmed, extubated with full return of consciousness, lateral and then semi-prone position is preferred, given excessive crying promotes bleeding. In cleft palate patients, particularly excessive crying promotes bleeding and which requires resedation with small doses of incremental doses of tramadol and ketamine. Post-op observation in ICU by trained staff, monitoring respiration, SpO2 and bleeding. With early resumption of sips of water, bleeding stops. Three patients required re-exploration within an hour of completion of surgery. Shifting in prone position in such situation, shifting them to OT in prone position, oxygenation and induction in lateral position, and quick intubation with ready suction in hand is a safe approach in such situation. Post-op obstruction, we do not take retracting tongue stitch. We do not take it. After extubation, patient must be observed for signs of airway obstruction, most likely to be seen in infants with pre-existing airway problems, may occur at any part of the upper respiratory tract. Possibilities are laryngospasm, upper airway narrowing, blood clot, retained throat peck, tongue swelling from retraction, inadequate mouth breathing. CPAP with, as said previously, CPAP with 100% oxygen, opening mouth and careful nasopharyngeal airway, or even simple gastric feeding tube. We use it as a nasal cannula and with 4 to 5 liters flow through nose, nasal cannula, and the oxygen, that is obstruction, is taken care of. Occasionally, we require re-intubation also. At least in this 9 years, we required 4 to 5 patients where we have to re-intubate post-operatively just because of laryngospasm. Okay, thank you. So this is from my experience which we have been doing at our center.
Is there any question regarding this topic from delegates?
Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for such a useful lecture.